Thank you, Dr. Greenwell. And I also want to thank the course directors for having invited me to give this lecture. This is clearly one of the scariest complications of the patient with cirrhosis, acute variceal hemorrhage. And we'll talk to you about treatment strategies mostly. I have no disclosures, but I will be discussing the fact that octreotide, torliprazole, somatostatin, and esophageal stents are not FDA approved. So just to set ourselves up in the natural history of cirrhosis, you have any chronic liver disease will lead to cirrhosis. But and what I want to also stress in this lecture is that we are at a stage in our lives where we have to stratify patients with variceal hemorrhage. And different therapies will probably apply to different patients with cirrhosis. So at the very least, what I have to say is, this patient compensated or decompensated? And the thing that defines decompensation is the development of clinical complications, variceal hemorrhage being one of them, not varices, but variceal hemorrhage, ascites, and encephalopathy. Once the patient develops one of these complications, the patient is now defined as a decompensated patient, and the compensated patient has a median survival of about 12 years, as long as they remain compensated, while the patient, once they develop decompensation, their median survival is about 2 years. So if you think about it, if these are the patients that are going to be referred for transplant, this is the time when they decompensate, because usually the wait time is about 2 years. And of the complications of cirrhosis, actually, variceal hemorrhage, when you compare it to ascites, for example, variceal hemorrhage, and this is a prospective study from Italy that showed that the mortality actually from variceal hemorrhage over time was lower than when the patient has ascites. Ascites somehow, because variceal hemorrhage can occur in the patient that's very compensated as the only decompensating event. And the reason also the mortality from variceal hemorrhage is lower is because we have actually succeeded at improving the survival of patients with acute variceal hemorrhage. And this is a series out of France, but there are several series like this that shows that the mortality over time has been decreasing over the decades. And in this particular study, the improved survival was related to the use of prophylactic antibiotics, which we will talk about, and the use of variceal ligation instead of sclerotherapy. So we can actually add something else that will improve the survival of these patients. This is a study in the New England Journal of Medicine last year that randomized every patient with GI hemorrhage, variceal or not, and were randomized to two transfusion strategies. One was a restrictive transfusion strategy where the patients would start transfusing the patient at a hemoglobin of 7 and maintaining it around 8. Versus the liberal strategy, where the patient would start being transfused at a hemoglobin of 9 with a target hemoglobin of around 10. At the end of the day, what you can see here, this is from 0 to 100, there was a clear difference in survival. If you amplify that area from 90 to 100, it's even much, much more striking, obviously. The restrictive transfusion strategy was associated with a significantly lower mortality compared to patients with the liberal strategy. So as part of this study, the author, who is actually a hepatologist, said, you know, I'm going to power this to look at patients with cirrhosis. And so one-third, more or less, of the 849 patients that were included in the study had cirrhosis. And I'll show you the results on the patients with cirrhosis. And you can see here that overall, and everything to the left of the line shows that restrictive strategy was better. Overall, patients with cirrhosis had a better survival with restrictive strategy than with liberal strategy. When they stratified them by class, however, if you can see here, class child A and B, they had a significant improvement in survival when they were transfused using a restrictive strategy. But when you look at the child C patients, the benefit was not there, which doesn't necessarily mean that you're doing damage to these patients by doing a restrictive strategy. It's that these patients are so sick already that a few of the things that we do for them is going to actually improve their survival. So clearly, but overall, the restrictive strategy is better. Now, when you look at rebleeding, this was also significantly lower in those who got restrictive strategy. This is in all the patients, 10% of rebleeding versus 16%. This was significant. When you stratify them again, you can see here that the benefit, the significant benefit in decreased rebleeding with restrictive strategy was observed in patients that were child class A and B, 11 versus 21%. But even though not significant, there was still a tendency for less rebleeding even in Child-C patients, 15% versus 28%. But the numbers were small, so that's why this ended up being significant. And this is sort of cool because the studies in animals had shown that if you bleed the rat with portal hypertension and you return all the blood that the animal has lost, there's a shoot, the portal pressure actually shoots up beyond the baseline and the animal bleeds more. And so in a group of patients in this study, they looked at the hepatic venous pressure gradient, which is a measure of portal pressure. And in 77 who received liberal transfusion strategy, they could see that the HVG actually went up, whereas it did not change in patients that received restrictive transfusion strategy, showing again what had been shown experimentally, that if you transfuse all the blood back, the pressure will go up and the patient is going to rebleed. Now, what about antibiotics? This has been shown that about 50%, and in other meta-analysis, about 50% of patients with a hemorrhage, with cirrhosis, and who get admitted with GI hemorrhage, develop a bacterial infection. And in this meta-analysis, you can see that using prophylactic antibiotics decreases the rate of bacterial infection significantly. But the most important thing is that the mortality rate goes down significantly. And much of this decrease in mortality rate is because the rebleeding rate also goes down. And we can discuss why this is. It's probably because with bleeding, there's more bacterial translocation, there's more TNF, nitric oxide, there's more flow into the portal system, so that increases the pressure and the patient rebleeds. If you prevent infection, you prevent these mechanisms from occurring. Now, what antibiotic are you going to use? So the theory behind the antibiotic is that you use selective intestinal decontamination. So you use a poorly absorbed antibiotic by mouth, like norfloxacin. And so for many years, we recommended the use of oral norfloxacin. Even though the patient's bleeding, it still worked. But then this study came out. But please note, this study looked at patients that had not only GI hemorrhage, but had advanced cirrhosis. These were almost Child-C patients. They had two or more of malnutrition, ascites, encephalopathy, and jaundice. So these were almost Child-BC patients. And they randomized them to IV ceftriaxone versus oral norfloxacin. You can see here that for the probability of developing any bacterial infection and for the probability of developing specifically SBP or spontaneous bacteremia, IV ceftriaxone was much more, decreased the development of these infections much more than oral norfloxacin. So the question is it because of the type of antibiotics? Is it because of the route of antibiotic, or what is the reason for this discrepancy? And when you look at the paper more carefully, you'll see that of 7-gram negative bacilli that grew in this group that explained this difference, 6 of them were due to quinolone-resistant organisms. And this study was done in Spain where they used norfloxacin prophylaxis like you cannot believe, so they had a lot of organisms that were now quinolone-resistant. So bottom line, the ascites club still recommends oral norfloxacin except in very sick patients, and particularly those that are receiving prophylactic antibiotics or in settings where you know that there's a lot of quinolone-resistant organisms. Now, and this was a question that I got asked a lot, do we need to give antibiotic prophylaxis to every patient with cirrhosis, or can we start stratifying? And let me show you, first of all, only 9% of the screened patients actually met these criteria. So this is a minority of the patients with cirrhosis and GI hemorrhage. So this is a study by Pauls in France many years ago, and he is one of the studies that's included in the meta-analysis that I just showed you. And he actually stratified the patients. He said, well, the child A or B patients that are not rebleeding, I'm not going to randomize them to my study. Whereas child C patients or child A or B that rebleed, and these were mostly child B patients, we're going to randomize them to no antibiotics or antibiotics. And at the end of the day, in the randomized study, they showed that the clear significant reduction in infection rate in patients who received antibiotics versus those who did not. But if you look at their group that was not randomized, the rate of infection was only 18%, which is pretty similar if you look at the group that received antibiotic prophylaxis, which brings up the question, do child A patients, do very compensated patients require antibiotic prophylaxis? And I'm showing you a study that was presented at the AASLD last year. It is a retrospective database, but this is a retrospective database of prospectively collected data. And they looked at the development of infection and 6-week mortality. and looked at it by child Pew score. So child 5 and 6 are child A patients. You can see here that they essentially, the difference between with and without antibiotics was not significant, and their mortality was exactly the same with or without antibiotics, which again support the fact that perhaps child A patients do not require antibiotic prophylaxis, whereas child C patients probably require IV ceftriaxone. So going next, what is our next step in the treatment of these patients? Well, we restrict the transfusions, we give them antibiotics for those who require it, and then we go on to vasoactive drugs that will decrease the flow into the portal venous system. And this is actually a meta-analysis. The only one that we have in this country is octreotide. In Europe, they use mostly somatostatin and terlipressin. You can see here that actually, this is actually sort of, I don't know if you can see this, but anywhere, anything that's on the right side of the line favors the vasoactive drug in terms of control of hemorrhage. You can see that the studies on octreotide, the studies on terlipressin, all showed independently that they improved the control of hemorrhage. And overall, this is the overall data, shows clearly that any vasoactive drug will improve control of hemorrhage. When we look at mortality, none of the studies by themselves actually showed an improvement in survival, but when you look at the conglomerate of all the studies, there is a significant improvement in survival in patients who receive vasoactive drugs. Again, unfortunately, all these studies were done lumping all the patients with cirrhosis together, so I cannot tell you about stratifying it in this setting. In a recent study, actually, what we always wanted to do was a head-to-head comparison, so this finally occurred with a hefty number of patients in Korea that compared terlipressin, somatostatin, and octreotide, and you can see here that they were exactly the same in terms of overall survival. So we're okay with that. So then the patient goes to endoscopy. What do you do? Clearly, everybody does ligation now, and this is the evidence for this. This is a randomized trial that's already old that looked at somatostatin plus ligation versus somatostatin plus sclerotherapy, and clearly the ligation arm was better in terms of survival, not only at 5 days, but also at 42 days. So this is our standard of care. When you suspect that the patient is going to come in with variceal hemorrhage, you resuscitate. Don't go crazy. You have to maintain the hemoglobin around 8. If you tank the patient too much, the patient is going to rebleed. You do give antibiotic prophylaxis. The first-line therapy is still norfloxacin, ceftriaxone in the sick patient or in the patient who's receiving antibiotic prophylaxis. And use a safe vasoactive drug, which in our case is octreotide. Then one does an endoscopy within 12 hours if the source is confirmed. And again, please know that the confirmation of variceal hemorrhage is either you see the varix bleeding, you see a varix with a white nipple where it seems that it just bled, or you see varices and no other lesion. Those are the diagnostic criteria for hemorrhage from varices. Then you ligate the varices. If you cannot ligate them, you do sclerotherapy. And then you continue the vasoactive drugs and the antibiotics. Now, this is the standard of care. If you fail this standard therapy, you go on to TIPS. TIPS is, in a way, second-line therapy. But who are the patients that are most likely to fail this standard therapy? And it's child C patients. Child C patients are always the sicker ones. And in several studies, these are the ones that are most likely to fail, the ones that are most likely to have the highest portal pressure. So this brought up the idea of what if we put in a TIPS before the patient fails? This is the concept of early TIPS or preemptive TIPS. What we're doing is we're going to select child C patients and another risk factor, which is child B with active hemorrhage, and put a TIPS in them right after we do the ligation, send them to the IR right away. And this was the rationale behind this paper in the New England Journal of Medicine that randomized 63 patients, 32 to early TIPS, and 31 to standard therapy, meaning they kept on the drugs. If they failed, they would go on to TIPS, et cetera. And you can see here this is amazing, all right? So, of course, not the sickest child C patients. There were 10 to 13, so they excluded 14 and 15-point child. Or child B with active hemorrhage, they had the TIPS placed within 72 hours. Most of them got them within 24 to 48 hours from admission, and they followed it for 16 months. As you can see here, the endpoint, there was only one failure to control bleed in the TIPS group, whereas there were 14 bad outcomes in the standard therapy group. This was very significant, but what is pretty much more amazing is the mortality rate. Even consider that these are sick patients. The mortality was 12% only in the TIPS group versus 39% in the standard therapy group. Without clear differences in encephalopathy during that admission. This study is a second study that shows this. There had been a previous study that showed this in a smaller number of patients and using uncovered tip stents. And there's a subsequent study that is sort of a retrospective study in the same centers that participate in this that confirm this low mortality in patients with early tips. Again, please notice these are very select patients. It's only 18% of admissions with variceal hemorrhage were the ones that qualified for early tips. So how do we conclude this? So what we conclude is that we're going to resuscitate the patient. We maintain the hemoglobin around 8. And we're going to start the stratification. The first thing I ask my fellows when the patient comes in and the fellow calls me and says, we have a variceal bleeder, I say, what is a child? Okay, child A, you're going to be much more liberal. Child A is very hard to kill child A patients, all right? So you may not want to even give them antibiotics. You give them octreotide, you start with a bolus, and then you go on for infusion. The EGD, maybe these are the patients that you can wait till the next day to come in and do the endoscopy, right? It isn't like when you swallow a battery, right? And you do a ligation if the patient rebleeds, for example. Maybe this is, again, I'm going out of the box, all right? And if the bleeding persists or recurs, then you go for tips. Child B and child C patients, you go do the standard of therapy. You do, again, antibiotic prophylaxis to both of them. You start with the octreotide bolus followed by an infusion. You do the endoscopy, and you try to do this clearly within the 12 hours. And you do ligation if you find that the source is variceal. If there's no active bleeding in the child B patient, you continue the drugs like standard of care, and you continue and you do the ligation. However, if you find a varix that's spurting or this bleeding is occurring in a child C patient with a score of 10 to 13, these are patients that once you've ligated them, they go on to early tips. And we're having our Baveno conference next year in April, where I think this recommendation, right now the recommendation reads, consider tips in patients who are child B with active bleeding or child C patients that have a score of 10 to 13. Next year, probably given the strength of the evidence, this may become a recommendation that goes beyond consider. The child C patient that's 14 and 15 points, it's a very difficult case because these patients are going to fail a lot. You're going to continue going with ligation and drugs, and what you have to do is accelerate their transplant evaluation to see if they're a transplant candidate. So part of the treatment of variceal hemorrhage is not to let them be discharged without doing something to prevent recurrence bleeding. If you do nothing, the rebleeding rate is 60%. This is totally different than first variceal hemorrhage, which is around here. The best combination over the years, these are millions of trials that have gone on, and the one that gives us the least rebleeding rates is the combination of ligation and drugs. Drugs in our setting is mostly non-selected beta blockers, but in some places they do non-selected beta blockers and nitrates. Now, the thing is, non-selected beta blockers at least act by decreasing flow. There's recent evidence that statins may be beneficial in reducing portal pressure. And this is a proof of concept study looking at simvastatin. Statins, what they do is they deliver nitric oxide inside the liver, so they will cause intrahepatic vasodilatation. You can see here, this was a randomized placebo-controlled study. They were taking it for 4 weeks, starting at 20 to 40 milligrams a day versus placebo. In the placebo group, there was no changes in portal pressure. In the simvastatin group, there was a significant, modest but significant decrease in portal pressure without changes in flow, which means that if the pressure goes down and the flow is not going down, the reason the pressure went down is because of a decrease in resistance, and this is where we think it's acting. And when they looked at the stratification, you could see that, well, these are the main results, but even in patients that were on beta blockers, there was a further decrease in portal pressure, and it occurred both in the compensated and in the decompensated patient. So based on this study, there's a study that was presented this year at EASL that compared patients who had bled, were now on ligation and drugs, and a group was randomized to simvastatin, another group was randomized to placebo. This is a double-blind placebo-controlled trial of simvastatin versus placebo in addition to standard of care with ligation and beta blockers. And you can see here, when this is, I'm sorry, somehow this doesn't show up, but when they looked at bleeding and survival, which was their composite endpoint, there were no differences. When they looked at rebleeding, there were no differences, but this is overall survival. So survival was significantly better in the simvastatin group. And it may be that simvastatin acts not only by reducing portal pressure, but by perhaps improving flow into the liver and somehow improving liver status so that they die less, even though the rebleeding rate was not different. So more to come about this. We're anxiously awaiting the publication of this paper. Now, TIPS has the lowest rebleeding rates, but it has side effects, so it's indicated as second-line therapy in those who fail. But if you think about it, the patients who have the least rebleeding rates are those that we call HVPG responders. These are patients that decrease their HVPG, their portal pressure, to less than 12, normal is 3 to 5, or more than 20% from baseline, and you have the lowest rebleeding rates. But not only that, it's sort of the simvastatin study. At this point, I used to call this treatment of varices. Well, actually, I think by treating portal hypertension, we're not only treating the varices, but we're treating the liver in general, because in this, these responders not only bleed less, but they also die less. And that should reorient ourselves as to what our endpoints are in the treatment of these patients with variceal hemorrhage. So in conclusion, variceal hemorrhage still carries a mortality of around 20%. The risk of treatment failure or death is totally dependent on severity of liver disease. We have to refine our stratification strategies. There's a paper in Gastro this year that used a new recalibrated MEL. So what they said, you know, we're going to recalibrate the MEL so that we can see what are the cutoffs that are good and bad. And they found a cutoff of less than 11 as being a low risk and a cutoff of more than 19 as being high risk. So we did a study we're presenting at the AASLD this year. Using a cohort in the United States, and we found that the CTP score was actually better calibrated than the MEL, than their recalibrated MEL, and we found that our cutoff with child A has less than 10% mortality, child C patient has more than 30% mortality. So what do we have for the future? Well, we have to investigate non-invasive indicators of hemodynamic response, because if we could tailor how we treat these patients by reducing portal pressure, this would be best. But the problem is the HVPG is an invasive procedure, and we have now convinced that this is not for routine use, it's only for research use. We have to develop therapies or combination of therapies that will increase the rate of responders. You know, we've been stuck with beta blockers for centuries, so it's time to start thinking of something new, and simvastatin is perhaps something new. And we have to redefine our endpoints in patients who have bled from varices. Is rebleeding really our main goal, or is this the survival of the patient? Thank you very much for your attention.